No, it feels kind of silly to have that music on after Dee played that beautiful offertory for us. Thank you, Dee. If you've been with us, we're in a series called Built to Last, looking at this letter that the Apostle Paul wrote to the Christians living in the ancient city of Ephesus called Ephesians. Many of you know this. It's a familiar letter to many of us, but perhaps not to all of you. It's been personally very challenging and affirming and also convicting. And I think we've talked about this as a leadership team and on staff. It's also been really challenging for us as a church staff about what it is we're called to lead and to serve the body of Christ, the church. Each week, these passages are familiar to many of us, but sometimes I find that I thought I knew these things, and God opens my eyes to them in a way I had not seen them before. But the passage we're going to look at this morning is one that I found many commentators and pastors sort of skip right over. And if I'm honest, it's one that I had sort of skipped right over in the past. I've never preached on this passage before. I've read it before, but sort of in passing to get to the next section. It's really an amazing passage. It's almost like Paul has a little digression, and I haven't concentrated on what he's saying there, but it's so relevant and important for us. So we're going to jump right into it. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 1 through 13. You can follow with me on the screen or in your own Bibles. Ephesians 3, verse 1. For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles, assuming that you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you, how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the same promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace, which was given me by the working of his power. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was according to the eternal purpose that he has realized in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in him. So I ask you not to lose heart over what I am suffering for you, which is your glory. I've never really studied this passage before. I've read it in my Bible reading, perhaps you have, but I've not really dug deep into it, and it is amazing. Four times in this passage, the Apostle Paul uses the word mystery. Did you notice that? The mystery of Christ. He keeps talking about the mystery. What do you think of when you hear the word mystery? What comes in your mind? How many of you like mystery novels? My daughter is a fan of the Netflix series called Sherlock, which is like a reimagining of Sherlock Holmes. Maybe you think of, you know, Sherlock Holmes. Elementary Watson, right? Everything's a mystery except to him because he understands how to read the clues. Or perhaps if you're of my generation, you think of the Mystery Machine, which was the vehicle driven by Scooby-Doo, and right? They don't all have to sit in the front seat. I always wondered about that. Why are they? Is it a cargo van? Anyway. We think of a mystery as either something to be solved, like a puzzle to figure out, a riddle to be solved, or as something that's unknowable, mysterious. You just can't know it. Well, it's a mystery, right? That's not exactly what Paul is saying here, and in fact, not at all what Paul is saying here. In fact, the Greek word is the word mysterion, and it means something kept hidden or formerly unknown. It comes from the root word meaning to close the mouth. You might say, Paul is saying, the mystery is that which God was closed-mouthed about before. He was tight-lipped about this, but now it's been revealed. Now it's been spoken. Now it's been made known and being made known. A mystery is something previously unknown. He says that in verse 3, that very thing. In verse 3, he says, how the mystery was made known to me by revelation. It was previously unknown, but now it's been made known. So what is it that God has now made known, which previously was kept hidden? This is the unfolding mystery of the gospel. The unfolding mystery of the gospel. If you were to just read verse 1 and then skip right down to verse 14, I'll read it, I'll do that for you. For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles, for this reason I bow my knees before the Father. Now, then he launches into this great prayer, which is next week. And many of you will know this prayer. This is the prayer where he talks about he who can do immeasurably all that we ask or imagine, that incredible prayer. It feels like Paul, verse 1, should go right to verse 14, right? But verse 2 through 13 is one long Greek sentence, one continuous sentence. It's almost like Paul has this little, like, sidetrack. He gets sidetracked in this little digression. He's about to say, for this reason I pray, but let me tell you about this mystery first. And that's so profound and so important for us. This seeming digression gives us an incredible insight into this unfolding mystery of the gospel. Let me read verses 3 through 6 again for you. How the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Again, mystery does not mean something unknowable or something we have to solve. It's a truth which, although beyond our comprehension on our own, God makes known to us. In other words, not something you would come up with or you can figure out by human reason alone, but something which has to be told to you. You have to be clued in, as it were. It's now revealed through the gospel. What's the mystery? What's the thing that wasn't known and now is known? In verse 6, he says it. This mystery is the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, partakers of the same promise in Christ Jesus. Now, that might not sound like a big deal to you. Gentiles is you and me. It's the Greek word ethne. It's where we get our word ethnic from. It means nations. It means everybody else. It might not sound like that big a deal to us. Like, that's the big secret? That everybody's included? But it's hard. It would be hard for us to grasp how the Jewish people of the first century saw the world. One of the central ways they viewed the world was Jews and everybody else, non-Jews, who they called Gentiles. This was a central distinction in their identity. We are Jews. We are Israel. We are the people of the promise, and everyone else is not. That was the clear dividing line, Jew and Gentile. God's people and everybody else. Us and them. I don't think anything that we can experience comes close. Perhaps, maybe, if you were a young adult or adult during the Cold War era, maybe, you know, the U.S. and Russia, communists and people of the free democracy during the Cold War era, maybe. Maybe Axis and Allies in the World War II era. Maybe Black Panthers and, you know, white supremacists. This diametrically opposed, us and them. It's how Jews viewed the world. That's how they saw the world. Paul is saying that thing which God did not reveal, and you would never have guessed, that is made known now, the mystery, is that through the gospel, there's no more distinction. That dividing line, that central us-them reality is gone. Now, the Old Testament does indicate that God had purpose and plan for the Gentiles. We read about Gentile conversions in the Old Testament. We read about those outside the family of God being God-fearers or, you know, brought into the family by faith. But it's sort of like there's a big difference to the Jewish mind between, okay, for you really, really good Gentiles, we'll let a few of you in, and now there's no distinction anymore. Those are radically different. Last week, Jay Katanas, who was a guest preacher over at our Kesslinger campus, said, you know, the church is not that the Gentiles are allowed into the Jewish thing. Neither is it that the Jews are now brought into the new Gentile church. It's a totally new thing. It's a totally new thing that God is doing. This is what the gospel does. It annihilates the distinctions, the walls we build. In fact, in chapter 2, verse 11, right, we read about this. He has destroyed the dividing wall of hostility. Pastor Brian talked to you about the wall in the temple, the court of Gentiles, the actual wall, but we all build these walls. And here the Apostle Paul is saying that this is the thing which nobody would have guessed, nobody saw coming, nobody could have predicted, nobody would have invented, that God would come into our world as a vulnerable human baby, live a perfect sinless life in our place, die a condemned criminal's death on false charges, rise from the grave. Who invents that? And then through that, he would open the door to the people that you see as them, that you see as other. Through the gospel, those distinctions which give you identity and security and purpose are gone. Those categories which define you are destroyed. This is what the gospel does. And Paul drives this point home in like three successive statements in verse 6. I don't know if he caught them. These would be radical, shocking things to say to the Jewish mind. This mystery is the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, partakers of the same promise. Heirs, members, and partakers, right? Your fellow heirs. Heirs, wait a second. Now, what's an heir? It's one who's going to receive an inheritance. Remember the story of the prodigal son, which is really not well named. It's about the lost son and the prodigal God, the prodigious, gracious God. But anyway, this son, when he comes home, the older brother's angry. Do you remember why the older brother's angry? Because he feels it's unjust. But why is he really angry? If you understand the economy of the first century, this oldest son, when the younger son, give me my inheritance now, and goes out and blows it all, loses it all, about a quarter of the father's wealth had to be liquidated. The money's not in an ATM. It's in crops and herds and flocks and so on. So in other words, the father sells off a portion of the family net worth, gives to the youngest son. The youngest son goes off and loses it. So now the family net worth is reduced by a quarter. Now the kid comes back, and his dad puts a ring on his finger and a robe on his shoulder and says, "Welcome back, son. You're back in the family." What does that mean? You get another quarter as the younger son. What's happening to the older son's share? It's now been reduced by half. He's losing in this deal, he thinks. When Paul says to the first century Jew and Gentile converts, right, in Ephesus, they're fellow heirs, members of the household, fellow partakers of the same promise. This is like, whoa, wait a second. Not them. This is us and them. I mean, sure, they can get saved, but they're in a different category, right? No, they're not. There are no categories like that. In the gospel, there's fellow partakers, members of God's household, or not. And that happens by grace through faith. We already looked at that a couple of weeks ago. This is what nobody saw coming, but what God was planning all along. Remember in Genesis 12 when he says to Abraham, "Through you I will bless all nations"? The Greek word for that Hebrew word would be ethne. Gentiles. Through your offspring, I'll bless all people. This is what he's talking about. Nobody saw this coming. Nobody predicted it. Just think for a minute about who's writing this. Who's writing this passage? The Apostle Paul. Now, if you don't know much about Bible history, that's okay. Some of you will know that Paul previously was named Saul of Tarsus. Saul was a Pharisee and a zealot. In fact, in Philippians chapter 3, he talks about his sort of spiritual pedigree before Christ. He said, "You think you have reason to brag? I was circumcised on the eighth day," which is a weird thing to brag about, but he brags about it. "But I was a Jew of Jews, a Pharisee of Pharisees. I studied under Gamaliel." He gives his educational background. He gives his religious pedigree. He gives, like, "I was a zealot in terms of keeping the law. I was faultless." His moral pedigree. And what was Saul's primary goal or mission or purpose? To eradicate these Christians. To destroy these people of the way. This Jesus and gospel thing that's propping up, he saw as something that was antithetical to the worship of Yahweh, the true God of Israel, and needed to be extinguished. That's who he was. And God uses that guy to tell the church, "Hey, those walls are gone." He knew about those walls. He cared about those walls. Those walls defined him. And now they're destroyed. Formerly, Paul was putting Christians in prison, and in verse 1, he says, "I am a prisoner." Now, if you do a little digging, you'll know that Paul was in prison a number of times. This is the first time he's in prison in Rome under Emperor Nero. He's under house arrest, which means he's renting his own place, but he's under guard. He can write and he can have visitors, but he can't go anywhere without permission or guards. He's imprisoned by Nero. He's awaiting his own trial, pleading his case. You can read about that in the book of Acts. He writes to Ephesus, "I'm a prisoner," but he doesn't say, "I'm a prisoner of Rome or of Nero." He says what? I'm a prisoner of Christ Jesus. In other words, what has captivated me now, what holds me, is not Nero, it's not Rome, it's Christ. It's the gospel that owns me now. I'm a willing prisoner because of his grace. He sees his life as held captive by the gospel. But think about that in my own life. I mean, I'm a pastor, so I think the presumption is, well, that's you. I want it to be. In some ways, I'm held captive. I mean, you had a choice. Do I go to church or not? I kind of have to show up. You'd notice if I wasn't here. But that's not what he's talking about. Not obligation. He's saying, my whole sense of self, my whole reason for being is now defined by Jesus and what he did for me. I'm a prisoner of the gospel. I'm liberated by those chains, in other words. Does that define you? Does it define us? This goes right along with Paul's statement in verse 8 when he says, although I am the least of all the saints, and that sounds a little bit like false humility. This is the guy who wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. I'm the least, you know. We've been around people like this, right? Oh, all glory to God. But they really mean all glory to me. I've said that. People say, great sermon, Pastor. I never know what to say. If I say thank you, it feels like I'm not saying enough. If I go, it wasn't that great. If I say, oh, praise God, it feels like, Paul says, I am the least of all the saints. And he's not being false. He's being genuine here. Remember, in other words, I've always marveled about this with Paul. I wanted to be like him in this way. He is a man of absolute confidence, isn't he? Boldness, fearless. I'm a prisoner of Christ, not you, Nero. But also great humility. Later he'll say that I'm the chief of sinners. In other words, his humility comes from knowing who he was. He never forgot who he was. His confidence comes from knowing who God is. I think we get those mixed up sometimes, don't we? We get our confidence from who we are, and we get humility. We think, because, oh, God's looking down on me. If I were to ask you this question, what do you think God thinks of you? What do you think God thinks of you? I'll bet most, if not all of you, if you actually thought about that question, your mind goes to, well, I'm a work in progress. I'm kind of a screw-up. He's patient with me. I make mistakes, but, you know. How many of you mentally go to things you ought to be better than you are in? Show of hands. If your hand's not up, you're not listening, or you're like an exception. We all do that. That's not what God thinks of you. That's what you think of you. I don't ask you what you think of you. If you're in Christ, God doesn't think of you that way. He's not unaware of your screw-ups, but he thinks of you as a beloved son, fellow heir, members of the household, partaker of the promise. Beloved. It's hard to get our minds around that, isn't it? Paul, who was as far from God as you could be, now is brought in. It defines him. That's why he can say, I was the chief of sinners. I was the least of the saints. Because he knows who he was. And he knows who God is. Notice the last few verses here, last few words of verse 6. He says, partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Those words, in Christ Jesus, that's identity. Through the gospel, that's mission. I am in Christ Jesus, that's who I am. And I am called to make a difference through the gospel, that's mission. They go in that order, by the way. Paul got that right. The gospel is a counterintuitive, astounding wonder. Nobody invents it. Nobody sees it coming. Nobody predicts it. This unfolding mystery that we're a part of. Okay, but how? So Paul then is going to go on to say, not only is there an unfolding mystery of the gospel now made known to all of you and to the world, he's going to say, but there's a singular way God puts it on display. There's a primary way God makes it known. What's that? I'm glad that you asked. It's the astounding brilliance of the church. Now, this sounds like a way over the top superlative phrase, but it isn't. The astounding brilliance of the church. Keep in mind, when I say the church, I don't mean just the local body, small c, this church, Chapel Street Church. I mean the church in the world, capital C, ecclesia, God's people everywhere all the time. The astounding brilliance of this thing called the church. Let me read verses 7 through 10. Of this gospel I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace, which was given me by the working of his power. To me, though I am the very least of the saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. That, verse 10, if you leave that up there for a while, that is really shocking. The mystery hidden for ages now made known through the church. What's the primary way God shows and communicates this amazing thing called the gospel? The church. Through the church. How different is this vision of the church than what most people in our culture think of? We think of it as something to attend, something to that we go to. Even this morning, perhaps many of you made the evaluation, should we go? Let's go. It's not church. I don't know if you're listening. The church is God's plan to reveal the mystery of the gospel to the world. When I read this and thought about this, even this morning when I got up early before I shoveled, it both thrills me and convicts me. The church in the world, everywhere, that little church in Russia that I went to visit, our church, everywhere you go, the people of Jesus who gather together, that's God's plan to make known the mystery of the gospel in the world. This whole passage or concept is really, it's almost beyond comprehension. And in fact, the phrase here that he uses, the manifold wisdom of God, that's an interesting phrase in Greek. The word manifold is the word polypoikilos, which is fun to say. Let's say polypoikilos. Okay, now, they changed it, good. I'm so grateful because before I had sent in the wrong words, it said manifold. And I thought, how could they get that wrong? I looked at the email that I sent and I got it wrong. But anyway, the manifold wisdom of God. The word manifold means polypoikilos, and that word means of many different varied colors. Isn't that interesting? The many-colored wisdom of God. Now, New Testament scholars debate what this actually means, and does it mean just the multifaceted wisdom of God? That there are many aspects to God's wisdom? Certainly it means that. But in light of what we just were talking about, right? The Gentiles. The mystery is this. Gentiles are now in. Fully in. Family members, sons, daughters, fellow heirs, partakers of the promise. Who are the Gentiles? Everybody that's not a Jew. They're many colored, aren't they? There are many ethnicities. There are many races. There are many cultures. They're all in. Paul uses this word, polypoikilos, to say the manifold, many-colored, multifaceted wisdom of God is made known in the church, meaning the diversity of the church, not just racial or ethnic diversity, but all kinds of diversity. It brings glory to God and says something to the world about the gospel. And again, not just the local church here, the church in the world. Do you know that Christianity is unique among the world's religions for many reasons, mostly because of grace and the gospel, but one of the reasons is that it's truly global. Now, you could make the argument, but there's Hindus in every part of the world and Buddhists in every part of the world. Sure, that's certainly true. But there's no regional center to Christianity the way there is for Islam, still the Middle East, or Hinduism, so the Far East, or Buddhism. There's no regional center in the globe where that's the place where it resides. The church, Christianity, really is global in that sense. The manifold wisdom of God is on display, made known through the church. The manifold, this is also sometimes translated brilliant. The brilliance of God. The multicolored brilliance of God in the gospel is supposed to be on display in the church. C.S. Lewis wrote a book called, many books, but one book that's lesser known, which I would recommend to you. In fact, I don't have a book from C.S. Lewis that I would not recommend to you, but this is one. Called Letters to Malcolm, Chiefly on Prayer. It's an imaginary conversation with a man named Malcolm. When he wrote it, people thought he actually was corresponding with Malcolm Muggeridge, but that turns out not to be true. He wrote to an imaginary man named Malcolm, and you only read Lewis's side of the conversation in these letters to Malcolm, so you can perceive from his responses what the conversation is about prayer, the mystery of prayer. In one part of one of the letters, he says, "You must broaden your mind, Malcolm, broaden your mind. It takes all sorts to make a world or a church. In fact, this may be even truer of a church. If grace perfects nature, it must expand all our natures into the full richness of the diversity which God intended when he made them. And heaven will display far more variety than hell." I love that line. Which means some of you will get to heaven and go, "What, you're here?" Heaven will display far more variety than hell. We'll share one thing in common, Christ and the gospel, because that destroys all the other barriers. The manifold, multicolored, multifaceted, brilliant wisdom of God. How's that on display? In the church. As I said, that both thrills me and convicts me. Now, you know this. You've experienced this. If you've ever been out of the country and worshiped with people of a different culture, you've sensed this, haven't you? You got a taste of it. If you've ever traveled to another part of the world and been around other believers, even if you don't speak their language, you see the brilliance of God, the manifold wisdom of God. When my wife and I were in Zambia this past summer, in Zimbabwe and in Botswana, which are fun words even to say, makes me feel exotic that I was even there. We went to this little church way out in the bush in Zambia. I mean, it was a long, rough, bumpy ride, way harder than driving through a few miles of snow to get to church. They didn't speak a word of English. But my heart was, I mean, I was weeping for most of the time. My heart was soaring in their worship. I don't know what they were saying. Went on for over 2.5 hours. I could have gone, I mean, normally we're like, hey, let's wrap it up. We got things to do. The manifold wisdom of God on display all over the world, where the people who are called by grace, the unfolding, right, mystery of the gospel is that the grace of God redeems all people. In the most unlikely way. So I would just say the church is central to the gospel. It's central to history, and it must be central to our lives. You know, over 80% of professing Christians, this is an interesting stat, I don't know how Pew Research gets this, but 80% of professing Christians say that you can have a perfectly legitimate relationship with God without ever going to church or being part of a church. All I can tell you is that's something you're making up out of your head. It's not in the New Testament. It's not what Paul says. He's not talking about attendance. You've been reconciled into the faith. Like you are who you are. Here's the American myth. Here's the American lie most of us believe. I am who I am by the choices I make. I determine who I am. I mean, sure, there's influences, but really, I'm making myself by my experiences and choices. That is complete baloney. You are who you are predominantly because of the community in which you live. The parents who raised you, the siblings who you grew up with, the friends you have, the place you work, the relational influences that surround you shape you in ways you aren't even conscious of. So do you think when you come to Christ by faith that it's going to be now just you and Jesus? That I'm just me and Jesus, I'm going to make this my own Christian life on my own? The hubris of that, it's ridiculous. You need a new community. You need a new family. You need a new culture, and that's what the gospel does. A new community to shape you into the man or woman God made you to be. It's the church, the manifold, brilliant wisdom of God. F.F. Bruce writes, "The church here appears as God's pilot plan for the reconciled universe of the future." I love this quote. The church here in Ephesians 3 appears as God's pilot plan for God's reconciled future, right? What God's going, it's a glimpse of what God is going to do for the world. This brings to the last point, the eternal purpose of Christ. So there's the unfolding mystery of the gospel, which is made known now, in the manifold wisdom of God, the brilliance of the church. And that, by the way, don't again, the brilliance doesn't mean like we're all very brilliant. We're not. God is. It's his idea. This is why Jesus can say, right, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail. He's building it by his manifold wisdom, not by our brilliance. The eternal purpose of Christ. The ultimate aim and purpose of God is to bring all things together in Christ. Now, I think one of the fundamental laws that's observable in our own life and certainly in the universe is that everything's in the process of decay. You certainly are. I can tell by looking. No, I'm kidding. Right? We're all breaking down. Paul says, outwardly we're wasting away, inwardly we're being renewed day by day. You talk to a physicist at Fermilab, they'll tell you that, right, the universe is expanding and disintegrating, it's breaking down. The second law of thermodynamics. Everything is in the process of falling apart and breaking down. But this is not God's intent and not God's plan and not God's ultimate goal. Let me read verses 11 through 13, again of chapter 3. This was according to the eternal purpose that he has realized in Christ Jesus, our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in him. So I ask you not to lose heart over what I'm suffering for you, which is your glory. Paul says, don't worry about this present struggle and suffering and trial that I'm facing or that you may face. Because God's ultimate purpose, made known through the mystery of the gospel and the brilliance of the church, is so much greater. If you could just get a hold of that in your mind and heart, then the stuff that you're worried about would just fall away. It just wouldn't hold the weight over you that it does. In fact, he's echoing here what he says earlier in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 9 and 10. Making known to us the mystery of his will according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. This is God's ultimate purpose, to bring all things together in Christ, to unite all things in him. It is in the church, then, that the reconciled community of God, that the world best sees God's ultimate plan for the universe. Did you hear that? It is in the church, the people of God in the world, that the world best sees God's ultimate plan for all things, to bring them together in him. How are we doing, church, at reflecting the manifold wisdom of God, at putting on display in our lives and in our love God's ultimate plan for all things? God is out to heal all the effects of sin, psychological, social, physical, moral, relational, and the place where the world can best see that is supposed to be in the church. That's what God wants to do. Look at those people. That's what God wants to do. God's mercy, his grace, his love, his justice, his power are revealed in the body of Christ in a way that, in fact, I don't know if you caught this. Who is it, is the manifold wisdom of God made known to? In verse 10. So that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. Who's that? Most people think, well, that's the angels, and it is. But that's the same exact Greek phrase that Paul will use in chapter 6, verse 12, when he talks about we wrestle not against the flesh and blood, but against the rulers and the authorities in the heavenly places, meaning the fallen angels, the demons. I had never seen this before, but it gave me goosebumps earlier this week. Paul is saying, not only does the world, this is Deuteronomy language, God says to Israel, if you obey my commandments and keep my law and live the way I made you to live, the world will see how good I am. It's not only that that is happening in the church, it's that God's brilliance, his manifold wisdom, is made known to angels and demons. What? Think about this for a minute. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 12, we're told that even angels long to look into, I think we have that verse here, do we have it? I know I'm out of order, but I just want to make sure you're awake up there, right? It was revealed to them they were serving not themselves, but you in the things that have now been announced to you through those who preach the good news to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things into which angels long to look. Did you hear that? Angels don't see everything. They don't know everything. In fact, Paul is saying quite clearly, they're watching you and us and the church and saying, wow, Look at the manifold wisdom of God. Who saw that coming? Isn't God amazing? Look what he's doing. Look what he did in their lives, in those people. So you could make the statement that the church astounds the angels and confounds the demons. The angels go, wow, isn't God amazing? The demons go, this is not good. Look at all these people he's redeeming. Look at all these people he's reconciling. It's incredible. It's not just that other people in the world see how good God is, but even the spiritual beings, angels and fallen angels, worship and tremble at the gospel on display in the people of God. How different is that vision of the church from what most of us think? And just to wrap up here, Paul says in verse 1, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ, and in verse 13, so don't worry about my troubles and my struggles, right? It's almost like the reason for this digression from Paul is because of his sufferings, his chains, his difficulties. And he's saying, these are nothing. Paul says in 2 Corinthians, right, our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us a glory that outlasts them all, outshines them all. This is Paul who says, to live is Christ, to die is gain. How free is that? You let me live? To God be the glory. You kill me? Hey, awesome. I become like him in an instant and I'm with Jesus. You can't touch me. How many of you, I want to live that way. I don't live that way. I'm worried about college funds and how my kids are doing and what, you know, the stuff I have to take care of. But I want to be that free. To live is Christ, to die is gain. Why? Because of the unfolding mystery of the gospel made known in the people of God, the manifold wisdom of God in the church. This is the eternal purpose of Jesus. We are a living example of what God's going to do in the end, bring everything together in Christ. If that gets inside my mind and heart, then what can the world do to me? How can it touch me? I see some of you here who have lost people that you loved and are with Jesus now. First of all, they would not come back to you even if they could because they're with him. But if they did, they would tell you, stop worrying. Stop worrying about all this stuff. What matters most, you already have in Christ. Can't be taken from you. Can't be touched. All right, we're way over time. I think the clock got messed up by the snow. Let's pray. Father, we just pause and acknowledge that this thing called the church is beyond our comprehension. Forgive us for being small-minded and thinking it means something we attend once or twice a week or once a month. Open our eyes that you have redeemed us not just individually and personally, but collectively, called us by your grace into a new family, a new thing which you are building by your Spirit. And in us, not just us here or at Kesslinger or at Mill Creek, but us in the world, you are putting on display the brilliance of your wisdom and the power of your gospel. We thank and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. For the benediction, I say this every week, but if you're here this morning and would like someone to pray with you or to pray for you, please feel free to come forward. Members of the prayer team would love to meet with you. Now, brothers and sisters, go in the grace of the manifold wisdom of your God, made known to you through Jesus Christ and in his church. To him be glory and honor now and forever. Amen. And go in peace.